My name is Eleftherios. I'm a first-year PhD student at EPFL, and I'm going to present our way on enhancing Bitcoin security and performance with strong consistency via collective signing. This is joint work with Philipp, Nicolas, Ismail, Linus, and Bryan. So Bitcoin has created a huge ecosystem around it in the last 10 years of hundreds of companies spanning from mining hardware companies, software exchanges, Bitcoin wallets. But in the last 2 or 3 years, the big IT companies and banks have caught up to this hype, and they're trying to leverage the underlying data structure of Bitcoin, which is a blockchain or a distributed ledger, in order to create new functionalities. For example, they want to create systems that have cheaper transaction management in a trustless way, more transparent, less error prone, or machine-to-machine payments in the context of the Internet of Things. However, this cannot be directly implemented on top of Bitcoin's blockchain. First, because real-time verification is not actually possible in Bitcoin's blockchain, a client needs to wait about 1 hour to be sure that his transaction will persist and be there forever. Furthermore, the throughput that at this point Bitcoin's blockchain provides is 7 transactions per second, which is very low compared to the hundreds that PayPal provides or the thousands that Visa provides. In this talk, we're going to change the consensus algorithm that Bitcoin's blockchain uses in order to solve this problem and create a more secure and with higher throughput blockchain. First, we're going to look a bit into Bitcoin and identify its limitations and where the problem is. And afterwards, we're going to start and step by step create our new solution. First, we're going to implement a very simple PBFT variant that has a number of trusted servers that have a blockchain and they're just agreeing on appending blocks. Afterwards, we're going to see what the problems of this variant are, and we're going to solve them by opening the consensus group so that we no longer have trusted parties but miners. We're going to change MAC-based authentication into collective signing to allow for scalability. And we're going to decouple transaction verification from leader election to increase the throughput. Finally, we're going to look how our system behaves. And in the end, we're going to discuss about its limitations and some future work. So, the big difference between Bitcoin and all prior cryptocurrencies is the fact that it has no central bank. Instead of a bank, there is a group of peer-to-peer nodes that together reach consensus on which transactions are valid. So whenever a client wants to validate a transaction, he's going to send it to one of the peers who is going to validate it and propagate it through the network until all the nodes have validated that transaction and have reached agreement on the new state of the system. However, the system is distributed, and as a result, we can easily have conflicts. So what happens if concurrently two transactions try to spend the same funds? Then every miner, or peer as I'm saying, is going to validate the first transaction he sees, and he's going to reject the second one. This leads to an inconsistency in our bank, which could destroy a monetary system, because if we can't agree where the money is, we cannot actually have money. Bitcoin resolves this problem by having a leader election algorithm in about 10 minutes, and this leader decides which transactions are valid. Not all transactions that are propagated through the network are valid, only the ones that at some point a leader decided to validate. This validation, this leader election is done through proof of work. So these peers are actually miners, and they are trying to validate transactions by mining blocks. They collect these transactions and put them in a block. Then they add at the header of the block the hash of the previous block to create a back pointer. And in the end, they compete with each other into solving a cryptographically hard puzzle. This puzzle consists of iterating through a nonce value until the hash of the header of the block has a number of leading zeros. The first miner that finds that block is going to be the successful one. His block is going to be appended on the blockchain, and the transactions inside the block are going to be considered valid at that point in time. So this is how the famous blockchain is created. We have blocks that point back to their parental blocks, creating a total ordering. This total ordering allows for serializability of the transactions, which means that anyone can just replay the blockchain and get the exact same state as the miners. So there is no need for trust. Anyone can see what is valid and what is not. However, the problem of conflicts still persists. We can have two miners concurrently mining a block, and both blocks are going to point to the same parental one. This, which is called the fork in blockchain terminology, destroys our total ordering and can potentially destroy serializability if transactions inside the red block conflict transactions inside the blue one. Bitcoin tries to solve this problem by waiting until a new block is mined, which validates parental one, and there is the rule that all honest miners are going to switch to the chain that has the longest, the most blocks, or the most proof of work. However, the problem here is that this rule doesn't guarantee that once a block is in the longest chain, this is going to be the longest chain always. We can have different chains mined, so at some point in time, an attacker probably is going to create a new fork that has more blocks inside it, and at that point in time, the two blue blocks that were considered valid from clients are going to just be forgotten. So, to sum up, the problem, the first problem that we have identified is the fact that Bitcoin has no verifiable commitment that a block is going to persist. Clients rely on probabilities to gain confidence of them on the persistence of their transactions, because the deeper a block is inside the blockchain, the exponentially harder it gets for an attacker to create an alternate history and mine all this proof of work. So, this is what we're going to change now. We're going to create a verifiable commitment of the system that the block is going to persist, and first step to that is practical Byzantine fault tolerance. We start with 3F+1 fixed trusted servers that run PBFT, and they run PBFT and agree on the next block that is going to be appended on the blockchain. This is already a lot better as far as security is concerned, because now, once a block is appended, there's a verifiable commitment that this block is going to persist. We do not have to rely on probabilities, and as a result, we no longer have to wait 6 blocks or 1 hour to verify that the transaction is valid. We just wait 10 minutes. Furthermore, we cannot have late forks, so an attacker cannot fork the chain after a block has been committed, and as a result, we do not have double spending attacks. However, PBFT was not created for a system like Bitcoin, and it has multiple problems. First problem is that it needs a static consensus group, so we need to already know and have a fixed number of trusted servers. Second and bigger problem is scalability. PBFT was and is deployed in a system of 4 replicas usually. And this cannot happen in Bitcoin, where we want to have hundreds or thousands of miners reaching consensus. As a result, if we use the same communication pattern, we get a quadratic communication complexity that can't scale to hundreds, as you can see. And also the other problem is that from a client's perspective, they have to verify each individual commitment, leading to a linear verification complexity, which is a heavy burden for lightweight clients like mobile phones. Finally, PBFT uses MAC-based authentication to increase performance, which is a problem in our case because we would need the hundreds of thousands of clients to have predefined shared secrets with the thousands of miners. This setup phase will just dose the system. So, in order to solve that, first step is to open the consensus group so that we can again have miners. And we're going to do that without suffering a Sybil attack, by using the same approach as Bitcoin, so we use proof of work. We again have miners, miners mine blocks, and once a miner mines a block, he gets the right to participate in the consensus. However, in order to maintain the balance of power that proof of work provides, we're not going to give equal votes to all the miners. Every miner has proportional votes to the blocks he has mined. This leads to a percentage of shares that is controlled by one miner to be proportional to his has power, and as a result, an attacker now again needs to control a significant significant percentage of the hash power in order to be able to attack the system. Finally, we're using a window mechanism in order to protect from inactive miners, so that miners can mine and participate in the consensus, but once they stop after a day or, I don't know, a week, they can just get off without risking the availability of our system. Our next problem is scalability. And so, as I said, we're going to substitute MAX with collective signing. But the logical first step there is to just use digital signatures. So if we use digital signatures, so we can use digital signatures a lot easier than what they could do in PBFT 15 years ago, because now we have elliptic curve cryptography, so we can be a lot more efficient than standard public key cryptography. And what we get is third-party verifiability. So no longer the need for predefined share secrets. We can scale to hundreds of thousands of clients because we do not care, actually. The only thing we need is a way for the clients to find the public keys of the miners. And for this, we have the blockchain. And the proof of work is enough to give trust to the keys. So now, the miners add their public key inside the blocks, and the clients can just retrieve the blockchain and get the keys that they need to trust. Finally, digital signatures enable scalable sparse communication patterns, like ring or star topologies. However, we wanted to do better, and we had to answer two questions to go as far as we can, as far as scalability is concerned. The first question is if we can do better than linear communication complexity, because we have to send the blocks and these costs. And the answer is already there. We know that multicast protocols can transmit information in logarithmic complexity by using trees. Second question was if we can do better from the perspective of the clients and not have a linear verification complexity. And again, we can use snore multi-signatures that are verified in almost constant time because they're using aggregation. Luckily for us, we didn't have to reinvent the wheel. We can just use the collective signing paper that was introduced 2 months ago in Auckland that basically combines snore multi-signatures with communication trees to efficiently and scalably create collective signatures. I'm not going to explain exactly how COSI works. You can look at the paper. But what we get out of collective signing is an efficient collective signature that can be easily verifiable as a simple signature. So for example, if we have a group of 144 cosigners, instead of having to send and verify 144 individual signatures that have a size of 9 kilobytes, now we just need to send 80 bytes and verify it with one computation. However, collective signing is not a Byzantine fault-tolerant protocol. We can use collective signing as a primitive to create a scalable Byzantine fault-tolerant protocol by implementing a PBFT variant on top of two subsequent collective signing rounds. The first round implements the prepare phase of PBFT, and the second round implements the commit phase of PBFT. More information can be found in the paper. And this is how we solve our first problem, which is creating a scalable and verifiable commitment of the system that the block will persist. We now have collectively signed blocks that are given to the clients who can efficiently verify the commitment of the system and be sure that their transactions are and will be valid. Second problem is that the throughput is limited by forks. There is this huge talk in Bitcoin about increasing the block size, but actually the block size cannot be increased a lot. Now it's 1 megabyte, it might be able to go up to 4 megabytes in order to get a bit more throughput, but after that, the system is just going to lose liveness or lead to centralization. In order to deal with this problem and have big throughput, we're going to decouple transaction verification from leader election, an idea that we inherited from Bitcoin and Zim, where they made exactly this key observation that mining blocks actually implements two different functionalities. First is transaction verifications. They are transactions in the block, so transactions are verified. The second functionality is leader election, which means that once a miner manages to mine a block, he gets the right to verify transactions. However, Bitcoin and Z also inherits many of Bitcoin's problems that we want to solve. For example, we have double spending attacks. A client needs to wait, again, 1 hour to get enough confidence that his transaction will persist. And additionally, in Bitcoin and Z, the leader is the master of his epoch. And this means that once he creates blocks, he's not checked directly. So he can actually misbehave and he's only retroactively checked. We do not really want that, and with collective signing, we can mitigate this problem. So what we get from Bitcoin and Z is having, again, two different kinds of blocks, just like in their paper. The first kind of block is the key blocks. They are mined through proof of work. They do not have transactions, and every key block has the value of one share. The more key blocks inside the window a miner controls, the more votes he has. Furthermore, key blocks are electing leaders, which means that the miner of the last key block is going to be the leader of the epoch, who is going to be the leader of the collective signing tree, who is going to be the one that gets the right to propose microblocks. Microblocks contain only transactions, and they're used to verify transactions. They're only issued by the leader, which is good because now we cannot have forks. There is only one entity issuing transactions, and he can issue them as fast as the system can handle. And furthermore, these microblocks, in our case, are collectively signed, which means that they are verified before they're given to client, so the leader cannot misbehave anymore. So this is an overview of our system that we implemented. And we have run extensive experiments on DeterLab, emulating up to 1,008 miners that were multiplexed on top of 36 machines. In order to have a realistic network, we imposed the 200 millisecond latency between the servers and the 35 megabps bandwidth per miner. These numbers are only in the connections between the miners. We do not care about full nodes or clients that are external to the consensus. We have a number of experiments in the paper, but the two big questions we want to answer is, first of all, what size of consensus group can we have in Bitcoin without suffering huge latencies? So can we actually have 1,000 miners collectively signing blocks in less than 20 seconds? And what is the max throughput that we can handle? Can we go close to PayPal or Visa, or we are again close to 10 transactions per second? In order to compare our system with other approaches, we implemented a number of them. We implemented PBFT. We also implemented a version of Bitcoin that doesn't use tree-based authentication, so the leader is just sending everyone the block, which is flat, but is a bit more robust when we have faults. And we also implemented two different tree-based protocols. One is the full Bitcoin, as I presented, and the other one is using trees, but doesn't use collective signing. It only has individual signatures. As you can see, PBFT scales the worst. I should note that PBFT couldn't use the 1 megabyte block that all others are using. It's only 250 kilobytes. And it scales really bad because of its N squared communication complexity. The flat based protocol scales well up to 100 miners, but after that, the links are saturated at the leader and it can't go any faster. While both three protocols scale a lot better, as you can see, up to 144 miners, they scale the same. But after that, the cost of sending individual signatures and verifying them kicks in. And as you can see, Bitcoin scales up to 1,000 miners with a bit less than 20 seconds of latency of collective signing blocks. Second question, throughput. So again, as you can see, we evaluated both collective signing and the flat-based protocol, and we have Bitcoin for comparison reasons. The 8 megabyte block in Bitcoin, there's paper showing that actually there is no security there, but we just have it. As you can see, even the flat-based protocol scales a lot better than Bitcoin. For 1 megabyte blocks, we get close to 100 transactions per second, while the tree-based collective signing, the full Bitcoin architecture scales a lot better. As you can see, at the 32 megabyte blocks, we can go faster than PayPal, close to 1,000 transactions per second. And this is done with a latency of about 90 seconds because of the cost of sending huge blocks. OK, finally, our system is not perfect. It has problems. And the biggest one is, what can an attacker do if he manages to get more than one third of the shares? So the first thing that he could do is just censor transactions. He can just not sign the blocks that he doesn't like. And as an alternative, just dose the system. If he stops doing everything, we lose liveness. The second attack is double spending, and it can be done easier than in Bitcoin. However, in order to be able to double spend in our case, the attacker would need to be able to split the network in two parts completely, which is pretty hard if we consider that we are at the internet and we're using authenticated messages. Another problem of our system is that it can currently only scale up, not scale out. If we add more servers, we do not get more performance. We actually get less. But this is a problem of all blockchain protocols that want every individual miner to have all the state inside them. Finally, the leader can actually play some game with the power he gets. so he can decide to exclude a small number of miners, less than one third, in order to gain a bit more revenue than he's entitled to. So as a future work, first thing we want to look into proof of work, into alternatives of proof of work. For example, can we use proof of stake? And we think we can a lot easier than in Bitcoin because we have a lot more increased security. Can we use sharding to enable scaling out? So can we split the state between nodes in order to increase our performance if we add more hardware? Another thing we want to do is incrementally deploy our system to existing cryptocurrencies. And we're open to collaborations there, of course. And finally, we want to look on ways to failing more gracefully if we get this 33% attack. For example, we maybe be able to detect the attack and switch back to the Nakamoto consensus where we lose our security and go back to the normal one, but have some liveness.
To sum up,
we use collective signing and manage to scale Byzantine fault-tolerant protocols from 4 to 1,000 participating nodes. We used proof of work in order to create hybrid permissionless Byzantine fault tolerance protocols, so we can have BFT and voting without having a Sybil attack by using proof of work. We combined these two with Bitcoin and G and created Bizcoin, which we demonstrated experimentally that it can be practical and scale. And we have an extensive security analysis in our paper on how we can defend against most double spending and selfish mining attacks.
That's all.
Thank you very much.
For questions?
Hi, Justin Kapos, NYU. So great talk. Interesting to see the work. So I wondered if you could talk a little bit more about some of the implications of what happens when someone like, let's say, a mining pool gets more than a third. Because in traditional Bitcoin, this is an issue that if someone just, let's say, only temporarily gets more than a third, because maybe they spin up a bunch of instances or they were lucky for a while, they can maybe temporarily do an attack. But in your system, it seems like if someone ever for a moment gets a third, then
yes,
what happens?
If someone gets one third and he wants to misbehave bad, he can stop signing everyone else's block and destroy the system. But
right,
we want to be able to detect this kind of attacks and then switch back to traditional Bitcoin until he goes back to not having more than one third.
Dmitry Kovratovic, University of Luxembourg. Didn't you try to reduce this 10 minutes period in order to have maybe a smaller blocks?
Well, the idea here is because we have these key blocks and micro blocks, we do not care about these 10 minutes. We have this key block that we get once every 10 minutes, but it's the micro blocks that get to verify transactions. So these are created about once every 20 seconds. So we do not actually care about reducing that in our case anymore.
But if you have a smaller period, then the Byzantine miners have shorter influence on the system.
I mean, if we have smaller periods, but if someone controls 33% of computing power, it doesn't matter the interval. He can just get what he wants. Or I don't get the question.
Okay, later.
Hey, Martin from Bochum University in Germany. I had one little question. What happens with the Coinbase transaction, and actually what happens with the Coinbase transaction when there are no more because the number of blocks was reached? What happens with the transaction fee? So how got they paid out?
Great question. So I didn't cover that here, but we have it in the paper. We no longer give all the money to the successful miner, but the Coinbase transaction and the fees are split equally to the full grid of miners that participate in the collective signing so that we can incentivize them to stay alive and not just mine and get away.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, let's thank our speaker again.